Hi everyone. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about clinical masking involved in speech audiometry. We are going to see about the criteria for masking, noises used for speech masking, the psychoacoustic masking procedure, and acoustic masking procedure. In speech audiometry, we track the speech recognition threshold and do supra-threshold speech test procedure like speech recognition score or speech identification score. In individuals where speech recognition threshold cannot be established, we rely on the speech detection threshold. Masking is required whenever cross-hearing is suspected. In speech audiometry, if the speech recognition threshold of the test ear minus interoral attenuation is greater than or equal to the best bone conduction threshold in the non-test ear, then cross-hearing is suspected. In this example, we have the air conduction thresholds and bone conduction thresholds. In the test ear, both AC threshold and BC thresholds are masked thresholds. Okay, now we are going to track the speech recognition threshold in the test ear. So it is amounted around 60 dB HL. Now when we subtract this 60 dB HL from IA, it is going to be 20 dB. And this 20 dB is going to be greater than the best bone conduction threshold at 1 kHz, which is 10. So cross hearing is happening. Hence, we need to provide masking noise in this non-test ear and re-establish this speech recognition threshold. This is a criteria for speech masking. With respect to types of masking noise used, a speech signal is a broadband signal. We need a broadband noise. So both white noise as well as speech noise can be used as a masking noise. Now the disadvantage of using white noise is that it has comparatively less energy at low frequencies. Hence, a speech noise or a speech safe noise will be the best option to be used as a masking noise. The psychoacoustic masking procedure has been detailedly explained with an example in pure tone audiometry. That video lecture can be accessed through the link in the right top corner. This method was given by Hood in 1960. It's also called as Plateau method or threshold shift method. This is the most reliable method used to track the true threshold of the test ear. This method is best suitable for detection tasks rather than recognition tasks. Detection task requires responses mere detection of the signal, whereas the recognition tasks like SRT, we require 50% of responses. So at each and every 50% of the responses, we need to re-establish the threshold. Hence, this procedure may become cumbersome and time-consuming. So in this procedure, we do not require any knowledge about the bone conduction thresholds of either ear or the interoral attenuation. The presentation level of noise is going to be the SRT of the non-test ear plus 10 dB. This amount of noise is going to be introduced into the non-test ear, and the threshold in the test ear is going to be re-established. We need to check for this shift in the threshold in the test ear. The noise in the non-test ear has to be increased in step by manner till a plateau is achieved in the test ear. Once a plateau is achieved in the test ear, then the true threshold in the test ear is established. Moving on to the acoustic masking procedure. This procedure is based on calculating the estimated acoustic levels of both test and masking stimuli during a test condition. It involves in various formulas used to calculate the masking level that has to be delivered to the non-test ear. The major disadvantage of this procedure is that it requires knowledge about airborne gap in both test and non-test ear to man or to calculate the minimum masking level. Leiden et al. Gave a formula for calculating the minimum masking level that has to be presented in the non-test ear. This will be equal to the presentation level in the test ear minus IA plus largest airborne gap in the non-test ear. When noise of this level is present in the non-test ear, it is made sure that it will not result in undermasking. In the same way, Leiden et al. Gave a formula for calculating the maximum masking level, which will be equal to the best bone conduction threshold of the test ear plus interoral attenuation minus 5 dB. So to calculate the accurate masking level of minimum masking level and maximum masking level, we require the true bone conduction threshold, we require the airborne gap and the interaural attenuation. Now with maximum masking level of noise present in the non-test ear, we can make sure that any amount of noise slightly higher than this level can result in over masking. However, effective masking can take place by providing a masking level which is in between this minimum masking level and maximum masking level. So Studebaker in 1979 came up with a formula to calculate mid masking level. So this mid masking level will be equal to minimum masking level plus maximum masking level divided by 2. This will be identifying the midpoint of this plateau method. So when we use this formula, this minus IA and plus IA gets cancelled. Thereby, the interaural attenuation or the effect of interaural attenuation is removed from the equation. The interaural attenuation has equal and opposite reaction between the minimum masking level and maximum masking level. Hence, this mid masking level is going to nullify the effect of interaural attenuation. Plateau is bounded by minimum masking level and maximum masking level. The identification of this mid masking level is going to ensure that it is always provides adequate masking. So this formula is going to give an accurate and most effective masking level to be presented in the non-test ear. Whatever may be the width of the plateau, even if it is narrow, this mid masking level formula is going to exactly provide the masking level which will give adequate masking. Studebaker also provided a simplified approach which does not involve in major calculations to identify or to arrive at the masking level that has to be provided in the non-test ear. The masking level should be 20 to 25 dB below the actual presentation level of speech signal in the test ear. So that is the presentation level of noise in the non-test ear. This approach will be only effective under two circumstances. They are, there should be no significant airborne gap in either of the ear, and the speech stimuli in the test ear should be presented at a moderate sensation level, that is 30 to 40 dB above the speech recognition threshold. So seeing these two conditions, this simplified approach cannot be employed when there is a conductive component, and it cannot be used for threshold speech measurements like speech recognition threshold. It can be used only for supra-threshold speech tests like speech identification score or speech recognition score. So that is the actual reason why this approach was introduced. But Acoustic in 1999 stated that it can also be effectively used for speech recognition threshold measurements. However, inappropriate use of this simplified approach can result in either undermasking or overmasking, especially when the plateau is very narrow. The width of the plateau is dependent upon the interaural attenuation. Hence, whenever an insert receiver is used, since they have larger interaural attenuation, the plateau will be wider. So if an insert receiver is used, we can directly use the simplified approach to mask during speech audiometry. In summary, plateau method is the most reliable method to track the true threshold in the test ear. It does not require any details of the bone conduction thresholds or interaural attenuation. It is most efficient for measuring speech detection thresholds. However, if recognition tasks are used, this procedure will be time consuming. Hence, this may not be an appropriate method for masking in speech audiometry. Acoustic masking procedure involves various formulas to calculate the masking levels of noise to be present in the non-test ear. The most effective formula is in identifying mid-masking level. This eliminates the effect of interaural attenuation, and it can be used for determining both the threshold speech measurements as well as supra-threshold speech test. So threshold speech measurement is speech recognition threshold, and supra-threshold speech test is speech recognition scores. Simplified approach is effective under certain conditions. It cannot be used in there is a conductive component involved, and inappropriate usage may lead to undermasking or overmasking. And this simplified approach is most suitable only when the stimulus is presented at a higher sensation level. Hence, for speech recognition score masking, this simplified approach can be used. So by comparing the advantages and disadvantages of these three methods, it is better to go with acoustic masking procedure, where we need to calculate the mid masking level will be the most effective masking procedure for speech audiometry. These are the references used for this particular lecture. Thank you.